Am I in trouble? Better than a deacon greeting you at the door right there. I mean,
don't you take your life's worth I might feel the same way too, but it's so much more than that, and it's waiting here for you. There's a way, there's a spark, there is a hope that you can hold on to. There is a lifeline up to the rescue, just like a hand that's waiting for you. And if you believe in this, I promise that you won't be alone. There is a way, the truth and the life and the way. There is a way, there is a spark, there is a hope that you can hold on to. There is a lifeline come to the rescue, just like a hand that's waiting for you. And if you believe in this, I promise that you won't be alone. There is a way, the truth and the life.
We are outside. Many of you have had your COVID vaccines. Many of you have had COVID. If you would walk around and introduce yourself, greet one another. You get about 3 minutes to go. Don't hug somebody, don't want to get hugged. Don't shake somebody's hand if they don't want to shake your hand, but walk around and greet each other. But you do have to move. So move. Walk around now. Move around. You do actually have to walk and find somebody you don't know.
Excuse me, I didn't want to put you anyway.
songs on Easter. We sing that song like all year long, but it is so nice to be commemorating the event of Easter, the advent of Easter, by singing songs about it. If you don't know the songs, I think most of you have them now on a phone somewhere, the words. Do you? Yes, maybe, possibly. If you need them, find somebody near you that can give you the words. We'll sing a couple more songs this morning. Darren, you gonna sing? Okay, let's sing.
Every song we could ever sing.
We are so grateful to be here in this cool place, seeing your sun rise, and know that you've given us one more day to breathe, one more day to have our hearts beat, one more day to think about you, to praise you, to be closer to you. We thank you for this beautiful Easter morning and for the gift of gathering. In your name we pray. Amen. You guys can grab a seat if you want to grab a donut or something warm to drink. Please do so. I forgot to tell you to bring a blanket and your sunglasses.
Where are you going?
You
gotta
have the sun right in your eyes this morning. Have you guys ever heard the phrase, you better recognize? Have you ever heard the phrase, you better recognize?
Yes.
What does it mean? Don't pay attention, don't get it twisted. When I was growing up as a teacher at Capitol Hill, I learned this phrase, you better recognize. I learned it from students saying it, and then I learned to say it as a teacher. But what it was meant to convey is that there is something you need to respect and get yourself in a proper position before it. Does that make sense? You better recognize that I'm the teacher and you need to listen to me. You better recognize that I'm an unhappy student, so don't push my buttons right now. Coach, you better recognize that the pit bull chasing us as we're running. You better recognize that we need to pay attention to what's going on. Today's meditation is Easter. We better recognize. We better recognize. I'm gonna give you three passages today that speak to me. There's so much for preachers to talk about on a day like this. You know that, right? That's why we fed you breakfast before we started, so you would have enough energy to maintain while I talked about this. There was a guy named Nicodemus. Anybody been watching The Chosen? If you've been watching, if you have, I've talked to you about this before. I'm going to start making you stay after church and do your homework, because some of you have not done your homework. If you have not watched this miniseries called The Chosen, you should. It's painless. It's free. It's on YouTube. You can do it. I mean, even when you should be doing something, I mean, you can watch it on YouTube. Don't do it at work. Your boss will get angry. But you should watch. There's a depiction of a guy named Nicodemus in The Chosen that I find intriguing. If you haven't watched it, they do a particularly good job of depicting. I mean, the character of Jesus is fantastic, but what The Chosen is really about is us. It's about the people that Jesus has chosen. And sometimes you have been chosen and you don't even know it. But there is a drawing of the Spirit, a drawing of God is calling you. He is pursuing you. He is wooing you, as they say, to be one with him. Nicodemus wanted to know about this Jesus character, but he was in a position where he couldn't publicly go to see him. The Bible says in a passage in John that Nicodemus went at night to talk to Jesus. And Jesus answered the most important question that you can ever ask, because Nicodemus asked it. He said, what do you need to do to be saved? Now, what Nicodemus was really asking is, what do I need to do to be saved? And Jesus gave him what appeared to be a very unsatisfactory answer. In fact, all that he said was unsatisfactory to Nicodemus as one who had done things his entire life to make himself acceptable to God and others. Nicodemus, you see, was a religious leader, and everything about his life was trying to do something that would make him acceptable to God. To obey all the laws and all the commandments, all the precepts, everything that God said was his work, and to teach others and to hold them accountable. What an incredibly nerve-wracking and exhausting job to try to do enough to be pleasing to God. Because you see, Nicodemus knew who God was. God is perfect and God is holy. And the more that Nicodemus knew about God, the more unworthy he felt. But he went to Jesus and recognized Jesus and said, maybe this man can tell me what I must do. And Jesus said, you got to be born again, brother. Nicodemus didn't understand that or didn't want to understand that. But what it presented was an impossible task. And Jesus said, you must do the impossible to be saved. Nicodemus, who should have known better, was sort of chastised by Jesus. But Jesus went on to say, let me explain it to you, brother. It's not about a physical rebirth. It's about the recognition that only God can cause your spirit to be reborn because you messed it up. You sinned. And in John 3, 14 through 21, we know some of the passages very familiar to us. But I want to begin with this passage. Jesus is speaking about himself as the Son of God to Nicodemus, a seeker who wanted to know how to be one with God. This is what Jesus said, just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes may have eternal life in him. Really quick backstory. The Hebrews had messed up again. They had wandered from God. Their lives were a wreck. They were always on this roller coaster, following God and leaving God and following God and leaving God. In this particular case, God was like, you guys are a train wreck. I have to purge my people of the sinful folk that are wrecking this and bring you back to me. And God, in his creative judgment and creative wisdom, sent a, I don't know what you call this, but it's not a flock, it's not a herd, it's a lot of snakes. Like hundreds of thousands of snakes. Not like one. I was in the garden the other day, digging along, dug up this little copperhead, chopped him up in little pieces and moved on. Not, that was one little snake. Still made me kind of jump out of my skin a little bit. But if you can imagine kind of looking over the horizon and seeing, man, it looks like the hillside is moving. What's going on? Well, this is kind of, looks like the hillside is moving down toward me. That's not a hillside. That's tens of thousands of vipers coming into the tent. The snakes came into the camp, into the tents, into the beds, and bit hundreds of thousands of people. The people are dying. But can you imagine what a horror show that was? It's like, some of you, that would be your absolute worst nightmare. Not one snake, but maybe millions of them. Not wondering if they're the bad snake, just knowing they're all the bad snake. All of them are the bad snake, every one of them. And then being stung, bit, maybe repeatedly. God did something interesting. He told Moses to make a serpent out of bronze and put it on a stick and hold it up in the middle of the camp and tell the people that anyone who gazes on this bronze serpent will be saved. Anybody who will look up at that depiction of a snake will be saved. They were not very smart people, but they were smart enough to know that there wasn't anything about a bronze snake that was going to save them. It was obedience to God and a recognition that only God can save them. There were still a lot of people in that tent, and those tents, and in that gathering, who did not bother to raise their eyes to look at that snake. Can you imagine? How'd your brother die? He wouldn't look at the snake. Your brother kind of dumb. What happened to your grandpa? He wouldn't look at the snake. I thought your grandpa was like a rich, smart guy. No, he's just dumb. He wouldn't look at the snake. So how'd you get healed from that snake bite? I looked at the snake. That's all there was to it. It was obedience to God, the power of God, bringing the deliverance of God. Not anything other than people just trusting that God could do what he said he was going to do. Jesus said, just like that snake was raised up in the wilderness, the Son of Man must be raised up so that everyone he believes can have eternal life in him. And then he goes on to say, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting and eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but what? To save the world. Whoever believes in him then is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned, because they have not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. Jesus says this is the verdict. Light has come into the world, but people loved darkness instead of light because their deeds were evil. Everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light for fear their deeds will be exposed. But whoever lives by the truth comes into the light so that it may be seen plainly that what they have done has been done in the sight of God. It was a day like this, perhaps a time like this, cool and dark, and before the world began to stir, that there were some women who had faithfully loved and followed Jesus, who went to the tomb of Joseph of Arimathea. You see, on Friday, when Jesus had died and been taken down, he was placed in a borrowed tomb. And these women who loved Jesus and had followed him had gone home mourning, but they prepared the spices to embalm his body with on that Friday evening. And then Saturday, they rested because it was the Sabbath. They waited all day long, but they were anxious to do this last thing for their Lord. And early in the morning on Sunday, probably much earlier than this, as early as some of you got up this morning, they rushed to the tomb. And this is the story of what they found in Luke 24. We find this, verse 1 of Luke 24, on the first day of the week. Very early in the morning, the women took the spices they had prepared and went to the tomb. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb, but when they entered, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were wondering about this, suddenly two men in clothes that gleamed like lightning stood beside them. In their fright, the women bowed down with their faces to the ground, but the men said, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He has risen. Remember how he told you while he was still in Galilee, the Son of Man must be delivered over to the hands of the sinners, be crucified, and on the third day raised again?" Then they remembered his words. Jesus told them, you see, repeatedly what was going to happen, and nobody was paying attention to him. He spoke it to Nicodemus, he spoke it to his disciples, he spoke it to those that would come and listen to him talk. He spoke it prophetically in the book of Isaiah. He has spoken it forever, that he would have to come and correct the wrongs that you and I created through our sin. But like these ladies, maybe we don't hear it so often. Maybe we don't listen to it, even though we have heard it often. Maybe we don't believe it. By the way, just because you don't believe something doesn't make it less true. Y'all know that, right? There are only about 7 billion examples of that in this planet right now. People who believe stuff that's not true. We believe stuff all the time that's not true. We argue about stuff that's not true. We're sure we're right, but you're not even right. You can be proven wrong and you still cling to this. We see it all the time. These ladies knew who Jesus was. They had walked with him, been in his shadow, seen him heal, seen him raise the dead, seen him give sight to the blind and hearing to the deaf and the ability to speak to the mute. He had fed thousands. They'd forgotten his glory. They'd forgotten his deity. They'd forgotten his words. Sometimes Jesus has to remind us of his words, even though we've heard them before. Now, you're hearing it from me. They heard it from angels. Wouldn't that be cool? 2 fearsome soldiers of light appearing in a terrifying way. Verse 9 says, when they came back from the tomb, they told all these things to the 11 and to the others. It was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and others with them who told this to the apostles. But they did not believe the women because their words seemed like nonsense. By the way, there's been nothing new since the first century about how silly Christianity seems to other people. So we think we're in a secularized modern society that has trouble believing in Jesus. They've always had trouble believing in Jesus. This is nothing new. But it does say that Peter got up and ran to the tomb. Bending over, he saw the strips of linen lying by themselves. And he went away wondering to himself what had happened. We also know from the book of John, who else ran with Peter to the tomb?
John
did. By the way, who got there first?
John
got there. He makes sure we know that he beat Peter in a foot race. If you read the book of John, he kind of brags on himself just a little bit in there. This is a crazy situation. This is something that has never happened. This is, oh, you almost got here. It's close. Thank you, Muzz. This is a crazy situation. Nobody knows what to make of this. We know from other accounts that the soldiers were struck so fearfully by the sight of the angel that they passed out, that they were terrified, that the women saw the empty tomb and declared that it was empty. People didn't believe them, just like they don't believe you when you talk about Jesus, the fact that there's a God. Verse 13, now on that same day, that would be later on the Sunday, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened. So what we believe is that these are two of the people that were in the room who heard the account of the women, and now they're walking toward Emmaus. That's gonna be a little distracting for a minute, but it'll go by in just a second. As they talked and discussed these things, I'm just going to wait just a moment because it's going to take a bit. They replied, he was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people. The chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death. And they crucified him, but we had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. And what is more, it's the third day since that took place. And some of our women amazed us. They went to the tomb early this morning, but did not find his body. Then they came and told us what they had seen, that they had seen a vision of angels. And these angels said that he was alive. Then some of our companions went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see Jesus. And Jesus says this, how foolish you are. How slow to believe all the prophets have told you. How foolish you are. How slow to believe all that your friends have told you. How foolish we are. How slow we are to believe what the pastors and teachers and the Word of God has told us. Did not the Messiah have to suffer these things and then enter his glory? And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained what was in the scriptures concerning himself. They continued walking along. And as they approached the village to which they were going, Jesus continued as if he were going further, but they urged him strongly, "Stay with us, for it's nearly evening. The day is almost over." So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table, he took bread, he broke it, and began to give thanks. And then he passed it out to them. There was something about Jesus' mannerisms that let everybody in that room know who he was. Because then the Bible says their eyes were open and they recognized him. And then he disappeared from their midst. They asked each other, weren't our hearts burning within us when he talked to us and opened the scriptures to us? This is an interesting thing. We have to decide as people about whether or not we believe that account and the other accounts in the gospel of Jesus Christ. It is essential that we make the decision about whether or not we believe. Billy Graham noted that there is more evidence that Jesus rose from the dead than there is that Julius Caesar ever lived, or that Alexander the Great died at the age of 33. Literally more evidence, eyewitness accounts, archaeological backing, that Jesus lived than that these other people that we take for granted walk the face of the earth. 1 Corinthians 15, 12 through 26 reminds us that if we do not believe this, if we do not believe that Jesus not only lived and died, but was resurrected from the dead, if we do not believe this, then we are a sad and pitiful people. 1 Corinthians 15 says this, "But if it is preached that Christ has been raised from the dead, how can some of you say there is no resurrection from the dead? If there is no resurrection from the dead, then not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, then our preaching is useless, and so is your faith. More than that, we are found to be false witnesses about God, for we have testified about God that he raised Jesus Christ from the dead. But he did not raise him if in fact the dead are not raised. For if the dead are not raised, then Christ has not been raised either. And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile. And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile. You are still in your sins. And those who also have fallen asleep or died in Christ are lost. If only for this life we have hope in Christ, then we are of all people to be most pitied." What Paul is teaching us is that everything we believe hinges on this fact. Everything we believe hinges on the fact that Jesus overcame physical death, that sometime between when he was placed in the tomb and Sunday morning, his body was literally reanimated by his own power. The cells began to produce again the things that cells produce that bring life. His respiration began to operate. His blood began to course through his veins again. His body began to heal itself, and he rose physically. Can you believe it? Because if you can't, we are to be most pitied. If we believe it and it didn't happen, we are fools. But this is, of course, the kind of conundrum that we're in as followers of Jesus Christ, that we would believe the unbelievable. And the world would declare us fools because of that. But the fact remains that if it's not true, then we are fools. We, like most people, would have adopted some type of placebo religion to make us feel better about our miserable lives. But there was nothing past our miserable lives unless Jesus is risen from the dead. Verse 20 says this, but Christ has indeed been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who've fallen asleep. Jesus is the first revived from the dead of all those who have died. For since death came through a man, the resurrection of the dead also comes through a man. For as in Adam all die, so in Christ all the dead will be made alive. But each in turn, Christ, the first fruits, the first, then when he comes, those who belong to him. Then the end will come. When he hands over the kingdom to God the Father after he has destroyed all dominion and authority and power. For he must reign until he has put all of his enemies under his feet. The last enemy to be destroyed is death. That's either really good news or really bad news. There is no middle ground for that. If you are found in Jesus Christ, if you are truly saved, that is tremendous news. And if not, and this is what you better recognize. We better recognize our condition. Nicodemus knew that as religious as he was, as well as he had perfected the art of following the commandments of God, he knew he had still lived a life that fell short of the glory of God. And that's what we learn in the scriptures, that every one of us falls short of the glory of God. We better recognize our condition, and we better recognize what that costs. The Bible is clear that the wages of sin is what? The penalty of sin is death. And not just physical death, although it is physical death, it is eternal death. It's the removal of our souls from the one that created our soul to be in relation with him. We better recognize our condition. We better recognize the cost. And today, above all days, we better recognize the Savior. Better recognize that Jesus is not a religious figure, that he's not a prophet, he's not a good teacher, he's not a nice guy, he's not a crackpot, he's not a fake Messiah. He is the Son of God. Jesus said that he was the Son of God. There's no middle ground around this. There's no way to avoid confronting this. And on Easter, it is something we joyfully celebrate, that the Savior Jesus has overcome death and risen from the dead to save us. We better recognize the condition, the cost, and the Savior, and we better recognize and accept the offer of Jesus Christ. What must you do to be saved? Bible says you must be born again. And providing an impossible task, an impossible problem is given the impossible task of following Jesus perfectly. I want to give you a few of these quotes that spoke to me about the reality of Jesus Christ on this beautiful Easter day. Tim Keller says this, if Jesus rose from the dead, then you have to accept all he said. If he didn't rise from the dead, then why worry about any of what he said? The issue on which everything hangs is not whether or not you like Jesus' teaching, but whether or not he rose from the dead. St. Augustine says, and he departed from our sight, and we might return to our heart and there find him. For he departed, and behold, he is here. Floyd Tompkins says, let the resurrection joy lift us from loneliness and weakness and despair into beauty and happiness. Josh McDowell says, no matter how devastating our struggles, our disappointments, and our troubles, they're only temporary. No matter what happens to you, no matter the depth of the tragedy or pain you face, no matter how death stalks you and your loved ones, the resurrection promises you a future of immeasurable good. I'm glad you're here on this Sunday morning, watching the sunrise and gathering to eat some donuts and think about Easter. But if we don't recognize Jesus for who he was, then this is a futile exercise. This is a meaningless observance. It's a way sometimes of fooling ourselves into thinking we are better than we are. Praise Jesus for his kindness to us, for his love for us, his willingness to live for us. He knows you. He knows your name. He knows your heart. And he is speaking to some of you even today. Had lunch with a friend on Thursday. And he's a friend who helped to launch the Bible app, which has now been downloaded 480 million times or something crazy like that. They have a new goal: to pray for every human being on earth by name. That made my head kind of explode. I can't even remember everybody that I meet, like, in the next five. I can't remember people's names very well. The audacity of this goal is really an interesting thing to me, that they want to actually out loud pray for every human being by name on the planet. I said, you better hurry up, a bunch of people are dying. And he kind of laughed and said, but a bunch of people are being born too, which is a good point. To pray for everybody by name. What a crazy idea that you could somehow know everybody's name on the planet and pray for them. And then it occurred to me that God knows every one of our names, knows our names better than we do, knows our person better than us. To be known by somebody is so essential, but to be known by God himself is just incredible. He knows your name. He knows your name. I want to pray for us today that somehow something that's occurred today has drawn us a little closer to our understanding of who Jesus is, and that we have recognized him as the one who has saved us. Father, I'm grateful. I'm grateful for the air that I feel on my skin right now, the cool breeze. I'm grateful for friends. I'm grateful for the sun that's warming my back right now. I'm grateful for food that fuels my body and rest that recharges me. I'm grateful for the word that I can read. But I'm so grateful right now that you saved me. And I'm so grateful that you rose from the grave, because that's how you've saved me. I pray that you continue to instruct and guide and teach us to know more about you. And Father, that today I know this is happening. Today, all over this planet, there are people who are turning to you for the very first time and believing on your name, and they are being saved today. And I praise you for saving however many thousands or tens of thousands of souls that are coming to you today. Thank you for saving us, for giving us the chance to live with you forever, to correct the wrongs of our sins, the wrongs we don't even know how to count. We know you have taken our sins and thrown them as far as the east is from the west, that you have forgotten them, Father, so that we can be acceptable to you. I thank you for Jesus' love and his obedience, for his life, for his willingness to give up his last breath for us, and then, Father, for his power to take up his breath again and fulfill the promise of Scripture. We praise you today for this gift, for speaking through our distracted minds and our stumbling words into our hearts, Father. I'm distracted by people that I'm thinking of right now that don't know you. And I know you know them by name, Father, so I pray for them. Lord, help us this day to remember you, to celebrate Easter, and to give you praise. We thank you for allowing us to pray in the name of the Son, in the name of the Father, in the name of the Spirit. We thank you, thank you, thank you. Amen. Friends, I'm glad you got up early to come and think about Easter. Some 2,226 years ago or whatever it would be. But think about the future that you have in front of you in Jesus Christ. Amen. And stick around, eat something sweet, get fueled up on some donuts. There are other church services to go to if you want to, but there certainly is fellowship here if you'd like to stick around for a few minutes. There's a gift you've got. If you don't have one, feel free to take one. It's just a little bit of something special that Rita put together for you guys and we want to send home.